Welcome to Lincoln House. I'm Armando Carbonell. I chair the Department of Planning and Urban Reform here at the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy. And this is one of our regular luncheon lectures. And even more regular, it is one of our Lincoln-Loeb Fellow luncheons, lectures with Peter Park. He was the planning director in the city of Milwaukee back when we started an institute that we do with the Graduate School of Design at Harvard and the American Planning Association, four big city planning directors. And then he continued with us in the city of Denver as a planning director, where he most recently worked. And along the way, he has also taught urban design, and I think continues to be a thinker and a teacher as well as a practitioner, what we like to call a pracademic. And he is this year a Loeb Fellow at the Graduate School of Design at Harvard, as well as the Lincoln-Loeb Fellow, which is an extra distinction. And he has been working on the topic of freeways and cities in America this year, and he is going to speak to us about that. So, Peter.
Thank you, Armando. Can everyone hear me all right? Is it okay? Thanks very much for coming on a day where the weather is marginal. My goodness. Is it always like this? And I didn't think so. Well, I'd like to first thank the Lincoln Institute, especially Armando, you, for your guidance over all these years and helping me frame some of my thoughts on this. I've been thinking about freeways and freeway removals for some time. Was, in fact, part of one in Milwaukee. So I'm going to share some of my thoughts so far. I'd also like to thank Harvard and the GSD for the Loeb program that brought me here, but also brought eight other fantastic Loebs, many are who are in the audience and who have provided great guidance for me as well. Ian Lockwood, for example, is an engineer who is a kindred spirit on this issue of freeway removals. He's probably the world's foremost expert on it, and we talk about it at breakfast, lunch, and dinner at the our house. I'd also like to recognize a number of organizations, the Institute for Transportation Development Policy, the Congress for the New Urbanism, Better Cities publication, the Next American City. There's just a handful of groups that are working on this very important topic, and of course, all of you. But I'd like to share with you a bit of my premise, if you will, of what I want to talk about, what I want to share with you. But first, a personal note, a couple personal notes. I'm going to talk about freeways, but I have to tell you, I should say that I'm not an anti-car person. I know some people are. I'm not. I'm just going to tell you, I'm not. I actually like driving when it's enjoyable. Having the top down on a nice day like today, I also like riding my bicycle, or one of my bicycles. I like walking in my neighborhood in very nice places. I like to do that as well. And I like to take efficient transit. I hate unnavigable roads. I hate sitting in congestion. I don't like riding my bike in a very automobile-dominated situation or walking in uncomfortable places. I like having choices. And so did my mom and dad. I'm actually U.S. born, son of immigrants who came here for a better life. And I lived and enjoyed a very American life here my entire life in both the Midwest, the East Coast, the Southwest, and the Rocky Mountain West. In fact, I grew up in a small town in South Dakota. I think it's the only capital city in the nation that's not on an interstate. Wow. So that might explain something. But here's my premise, all right? My premise is basically this, that I think it's simply un-American for us to use taxpayer dollars in ways that devalue private property. We are at the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy. In cities, what would be, what could be, what should be the most valuable real estate in our country? And so what I'd like to do is share with you sort of a discussion in three parts, and I would like it to be interactive as well, and I'll let you know when I need your help. This is some initial thinking that I've been doing. I'm not done yet. There's still a lot to learn, but here's where I am so far. So I'd like to talk about the historic freeway campaign, and I'm actually going to spend some time on this because I think it's important to understand the forces that are at work in what we're trying to overcome now. what I call America's failed experiment. Guess what that's about? And about the opportunity for a new campaign. And so with the historic freeway campaign, I'm going to talk about civic vision and civic will. Civic vision in terms of physical ideas from Corbeau to Disney. civic will and the power of communities to support or oppose changes in their neighborhoods. In terms of the failed experiment, I'd like to talk about the damage caused by freeways in cities, an example of successful rethinks, as I might call them, and what I think is an opportunity today, given our infrastructure challenges in our country and the economic realities of our country. I'd like to get your thoughts on whether it makes sense to build a campaign built on the same values but informed by new pragmatism. A new pragmatism that supports the mutual interests of rural, suburban, and urban dwellers, if that's possible. First, sort of pre-World War II, the historic freeway campaign. You know, cities, American cities, industrial American cities, were probably pretty rough, nasty places about 100 years ago, resulting from industrialization and growth. We had this impressive industrial apparatus. These are pictures, I think, that many people have seen depicting what was happening at the time. And at the time, about 1922 anyways, Henry Ford said, we shall solve the problem of the city by leaving the city. The problem of the city by leaving the city. That's how some people deal with their problems. They leave them, right? I actually, as a city planner, like to confront them. And a second major influence I think that's important to recognize, of course, is that of modern design and modern architecture and thinking about modern planning, really moving from to a city of objects versus places. Corbeau's fascination, of course, with fast cars at the time in 1924, cars, cars, fast, fast, and his proposal for something that never really existed before, you know, the notion of a freeway elevated, carrying high capacity, fast cars, never congested. How could it be? Everything's moving so fast. But also the notion of eschewing the tubular old Paris for new forms, a fixation on the form of the city made possible from new ferroconcrete construction. So in this sort of pre-World War II phase, we also have what my colleague Anne-Marie suggested was almost like a perfect storm, and that is where we had enormous industry, enormous cooperation between business and government, almost to the point of it being not just for profit, but for duty and responsibility. Government at the time was trying to get the country out of the mud, connecting towns and food supplies to cities. In terms of the financial future, military security, those were certainly firmly in the hearts and minds of many Americans after the World Wars, the stock market crash, the Depression, so forth. And so you have this idea of design professionals eschewing the past and reinventing the city, legacies of folks, for example, who are very famous around here. And you have this powerful alignment of American business, government, and people. Now, post-World War II and the 50s and what I call the freeway campaign, and it really was a campaign as much as there was a lot of, I think, mutual cooperation between industry and government, the people still need to be sold, I think. And I would be open to folks' thoughts about that. And it seemed to me, I was reviewing a number of documents and some videos, and there are a few recurring themes. Notions of freedom and prosperity, these are core American values, as we all know. And also, when it came to the proposal of a freeway or the selling or the campaign of an idea of making a freeway, the idea of congestion relief and improving safety. Now, if you read most engineering analyses today, these are the two that really stand out, right? You'll always find congestion relief discussed, because why else would we do anything, and better safety. And by the way, does anybody not want less congestion and more safety, right? Okay. So they're very, very very powerful in a way and simple. That's part of our challenge. I'll talk about it some more. So what I'd like to share with you is actually this is a document, Freedom of the American Road, that was produced in somewhere in the mid-50s. This is Henry Ford II. And it chronicled different cities. Now the message in this video, you'll get a sense of it. It really is a message to the people. And what can an ordinary citizen do about our shared problem? So here you'll hear from Henry Ford II. And this will run for, a couple minutes or something, okay?
I am Henry Ford II. In recent years, there has been a lot of talk about our highway situation. So much has been said that I feel sure a great many of you must have wondered, as I did, whether there was anything a private citizen could do about a problem so big. That's why we decided to study the situation. The results are published in this book. We call it Freedom of the American Road, simply because we Americans always have liked plenty of elbow room, freedom to come and go as we please in this big country of ours. The first thing we found was that you can't talk about highways without talking about traffic and safe driving, too. We found that there are many experienced highway and traffic safety experts who are doing a great service to the public. What they need is public understanding and support. But the most important thing we discovered was that already many private citizens in states and communities across the nation have gotten together to tackle their local problems with real success. We present a few of their stories in this motion picture. We do so with pride, for here, it seems to me, is real democracy in action. And now for a first-hand report, let's go to our Traffic Safety and Highway Improvement Department and our reporter, Westbrook Van Voorhees.
For our first story on what a community did about a dangerous local highway situation, we take you to fast-growing California, where highway problems have multiplied with the increase of population and of travel. This is San Francisco.
Okay. So you can download this video and watch the whole thing.
But they go across the country and talk about what citizens in their communities have done. Right? Henry Ford II appealing to the American public to listen to the experts. They need our support. And here's proof that citizens can do something about it. Right? We just need to keep going. Right? So here's another video. It's done a little bit later. This was GM. I'm not playing any favorites here, by the way. There's some common themes in this as well.
Though we have the greatest highway system in all the world, it can't carry the mounting traffic of our growing greatness. We're running out of road. We didn't dream big enough. Here's the problem, all mapped out. 3,300,000 miles of it.
Okay. We got it all mapped out. We just need your support.
We didn't plan big enough. We didn't vision big enough. Right? The music actually helps the whole thing, doesn't it? Okay. So these were the, I mean, these are just a couple of examples. There are a number of films like this. And I suppose they were shown just about everywhere, every opportunity that one could find to reach an audience. And they have very common messaging all the way through. So thanks for indulging me in reviewing. I have a couple more to show you, by the way. Actually, maybe I should have called this like movie night on freeways or something. So you can understand, I think, some of the ideas about freedom and prosperity, about almost a civic duty to support this. Now, that was in the mid-50s. But actually, you know, in 1937, the Germans had been working in the Autobahn. So this was like an idea that was nearly 20 years old, in the world anyways. The Germans had some very interesting films too. Here's one, and they're very similar in their messaging sometimes. Oops. Different music score. If you can't see it, it says, we'll drive through north through Bavaria. So they're starting on a country road, okay? And, oops. Sorry, I wasn't doing that for comic purposes. We'll drive to the north, to the German border. After a tough examination of our papers, we'll sail through the border and look at the New Germany. Off these, you know, dirt roads. But we're getting ready. Things have changed in the last 6 years. Everyone seems so industrious and orderly. An unnervingly determined spirit has taken hold. We drive onto one of the new Autobahns, a highway with no stop signs. We drive, yeah. Autos routinely streak along at speeds exceeding 50 miles per hour. Ordering from Vienna to Berlin, 1937. Well, you know what happened in your history lesson, and but it's interesting. There were reports that were done in the progress of this project, and it's sort of an interesting thing. You see the outline of Germany, and you see these highway lines that radiate and begin to point east and south in all directions. There's an idea there, I think, probably underlying. So in the United States, we got our act together, almost 20 years later. So you can understand, I think, maybe some of the pent-up envy and feeling like we're behind and we have to do something about it. And, you know, so this was the Federal Aid Highway Act of 1956, popularly known as the National Interstate and Defense Acts that, you know, President Eisenhower. Is famous for and signed the bill. It was an original project of about 41,000 miles, $25 billion in a construction period of 10 years, with a 90-10 distribution in terms of 90% federal dollars, 10% local, state. And the original plan was that by 1972, this would kind of be done. You know, the project would be figured out. This act also included basically creating the ability to tax fuel in order to pay for this project. And it would, don't worry, we've worked out the math, it'll pay for itself. It worked for a while. This is 1958. Any of you watched Disney in 1958? So I'll take you back there. This was an interesting thing in that there was this project of these films, then became sort of deeper into popular culture in every Sunday evening, I think. And here are just a few fantasy ideas.
A little too eccentric to ever reach the final blueprint stage. However, there are highway experts.
Those experts.
Who try to predict more seriously what the highway of the future will be like.
More seriously.
Now, let's take a realistic look at the road ahead and what tomorrow's motorist can expect in the years to come.
A realistic.
Speed, safety, and comfort will be the keynotes of tomorrow's highways. A multicolored highway system may enable the motorist to reach his destination by following the correct color strip. The increased speed of tomorrow's automobile will demand that highway signs be larger and more simple to read, so that the motorist can anticipate his moves well in advance. Better visibility will be featured in new highway designs. As day dims into night, electric eyes automatically illuminate the way ahead. Radiant heat will keep the highway surfaces dry through rain, ice, and snow. If visibility is poor, our windshield becomes a radar screen, showing the outline of objects ahead. Or fog may be eliminated by dispelling devices along the right-of-way. Dashboard panels featuring built-in safety controls and electronic operating devices are predictions for tomorrow. A teletype panel shows up with a minute traffic bulletins. The recommended safe driving speed is automatically indicated. Our rearview mirror is actually a television picture.
You can actually get all these things now. So there's this fascination with science, engineering, and it's absolutely inspiring and realistic and practical, as you can see. Here's another set that also shows you not only the technology, but maybe a little bit of an underlying idea of what the reach of all of this might be.
A giant road builder changes rough ground into a wide finished highway. Prefabricated bridges and overpasses move immediately into place. Combining new formulas of concrete with quick-setting ceramic materials, a mobile kill is supported by the bridge it builds. For tunneling through mountains, this atomic reactor applying incredible heat literally melts the hard rock as it makes molehills out of mountains. Here is preserved the beauty and grandeur of mountain travel with the use of cantilevered skyways. The shape of our cities will change as expanded highway transportation decentralizes our population centers into vast urban areas. With the advent of wider, faster expressways, the commuter's radius will be extended many miles. America will someday be crisscrossed by a network of super speed transcontinental motorways.
Transcontinental, right? So much so.
Highway and automotive design will move forward together. First, we'll have the more efficient gas turbine car, then the speedier jet, the inexhaustible atom, and possibly the sun-powered electro-suspension car, which needs no wheels. These spectacular conceptions will lead to new dimensions for the American highway. Visionary ideas which today seem sheer fantasy will be commonplace to future generations. There will be miles of tubular highways.
air-conditioned routes across hot desert wastelands, over sub-freezing mountain ranges, and even under the ocean. These giant arteries will link together all nations and help create a better understanding among the peoples of the world. As in the past, the highway will continue to play a vital role in the progress of civilization. It will be our magic carpet to new hopes, new dreams, and a better way of life for the future.
I was just in India with my Loeb Fellowship class, and we were in Mumbai. We actually were on that. It's called the Sea Link, and it goes out over the water. It's a big highway that goes out over the water just to avoid going over the land. Okay, I know it was Disney, but at the same time, right, this is capturing, I think, the spirit of a culture and a way of thinking, and was highly supported. So that was mid-50s, and of course, thanks to Jane Jacobs, there was clear recognition of response, a different way of empowering people. If any of you don't know Anthony Flint's book, Wrestling with Moses, it's a fantastic read. It's a terrific book. This ushered in a new way of thinking about what neighborhoods and people could do relative to this question about the freeway, right? And it's a pretty well-known story. But then I was sort of intrigued when I found on the Lucy Show an episode called Main Street USA. And I'm going to run through these four. But this gives you some sense of maybe a changing point of view in popular culture about freeways.
Oh, well.
What's the say about you?
The banker Theodore Mooney arriving in town to confer with Highway Planning Commission.
Well, that sure is nice of them putting your picture in the paper, huh?
Well, they should. I worked hard to convince the Highway Commission that a freeway through Main Street here would bring this town progress and prosperity.
How? Mm-hmm. I thought that you wanted the freeway through here so you could build your big shopping center.
Mrs. Carmichael, I assure you, my motives were most honorable and in the best interest of the community. Mrs. Carmichael!
I didn't say anything.
I know, but I don't like the tone of what you're not saying.
So you see the dilemma, right? And Lucy is reintroduced to her memories of Main Street. Public meeting in a public space on a main street. Can you imagine? So then Lucy goes to meet with the mayor.
Your Honor, may I say that I think it would be a terrible shame to put a freeway right down your main street. It is so beautiful. I visited all your shops, and I was in old Doc Putnam's drugstore, and I walked all around. Oh, I just loved the parade this morning.
One more blow and out you go. I'm sorry, sir.
plant, but the oil plant will come right here, right through Doc Putnam's drugstore.
Oh, you can't do that.
Why not?
Well, how can old Doc Putnam and Mr. Bubbles play chess on an off ramp? That you're so proud of. Without Main Street, you know, you'll be holding your plays on a freeway. You start off with 76 trombones and wind up with one piccolo player. Hey, Mr. Weber, you were born and raised here. These are your people. Can't you do something to get out of this mess?
Lady, I can't even get out of this tuba.
Your Honor, can't you do something?
Mrs. Carmichael, will you keep out of this? I appreciate your sentimentality, Mrs. Carmichael, but I have to be realistic and consider progress.
Well, if you ask me...
Nobody else!
I think we'd be making a lot more progress if we had a lot more wonderful little towns like Bancroft.
What do you mean, we? You're not even a citizen here!
I'm not the only one that feels like this, and you'll find that out tonight. Now look, Your Honor, can't you convince the men on the Highway Commission that Main Street is more than just a street? Why, it's a way of life. If I lived here in Bancroft, you know what I'd do. I'd get up a petition about this. And at that meeting tonight, I'd say, who needs industry and commerce and all that high-polluting, air-polluting progress?
So guess what happens?
'68, right? So, people, you know, you're not even from here,
right? What do you care? An interesting mix of same ideas, same hopes, same notions about what's an American tradition, same hopes about a better future. But in popular culture, clearly some, I'm pretty sure there wasn't an automobile company that sponsored that night's episode. Soap, maybe, or something like that. So I thought I would share that with you because, you know, we still have this question about how do these ideas, this is something I'm very curious about, if how do these ideas persist? And especially this sort of myth of freedom and prosperity, congestion relief, improved safety, they've endured, even though time after time, our reality is very different, right? I mean, when lanes have been added to highways, has congestion actually been relieved, you know? Safety may be for automobiles, but you know, we saw some significant rise in fatalities and vehicle miles traveled. Both are coming down. Injuries, fatalities, maybe at a higher rate, but some people attribute that to just safer cars. I mean, my goodness, how many airbags do you have in your car now, right? It's like a bubble, right? A whole number of things that may be changing some of the metrics of how we measure safety. But again, most of the discussion about these highway investments have to do with safety for the cars moving, not so much for everyone else. If I had a picture of it, I would show you the airport road out to DIA in Denver, which is not an interstate, it looks like one. The speed limit is 65 miles an hour, and there's a bike lane on the side. There's really a yellow sign with a bike and about 10 feet for you to ride your bicycle, or if someone has a flat, they're going to take up the space, and then I don't know where you're going to go. But not, you know, that's not quite, I think, what we mean by multimodal. All right. So, but there were a number of subsequent Surface Transportation Assistance Act in 82, ICE-T in 90, a whole number of different acts by Congress supporting, adding to that original fund when things went a little dry, increasing the gas tax. Interestingly, under more Republican administrations than Democrat, I think, I'll count it again, but 2005, under Safety Lou, the Lou, L-U, is legacy for users, by the way, was the last multi-year decision, right? And since then, we've had the era of 2009, and recently the Senate passed the 2012 $109 billion transportation bill. And there are a number of elements in it. But I couldn't find things that really spoke to flexibility if communities found that they didn't need to expand a freeway, let's say. Like, could they use the money to take down a freeway if they wanted to? I find the situation in Denver, and all the DOT folks say, well, we've got this bridge money. We've got to rebuild I-70. It's failing. I think, well, we should study it. Maybe it could go in a couple of other alignments. Well, then we would lose the funding. Well, maybe we could use the money in a different way. Like taking a bridge down, there's a bridge still associated there. So this is the kind of flexibility that maybe we need. So I want to talk a little bit about this failed experiment and what that means. It was an ambitious experiment. It was a new approach, never been done before, right? We never built in this manner before. And the aspirations, like in that Disney video, were pretty high, but I think that combined with design ideas and planning and architecture ideas left out some fundamental elements and design principles that shaped civilization actually for thousands of years and served humans for thousands of years. And it was a strong belief in science, in technology, and that we could, you know, science our way out of these things. So that in less than 80 years, we've created a new system of growth that makes us significantly dependent on scarce resources, consumes land inefficiently, paving, building over natural habitat, affecting our water systems, building over productive agrarian land, maybe even threaten our own existence. Okay, back to freeways in cities. Okay. We talk about, is there evidence of this damage, right? I don't think it's really hard. Like, you don't really have to look very, very hard. This didn't take deep research to figure this one out. Right? But ask a couple simple questions. Where did a city or a neighborhood get better from a freeway running through, over, or near the neighborhood? Where has that happened? And where has it actually delivered on the promises of freedom and prosperity for the surrounding neighborhoods? I actually haven't found such a place. Another simple question. Where has a freeway expansion actually delivered long-term congestion relief and safety? As I mentioned earlier, sometimes people debate whether it's better road design or better cars. It's probably a little bit of both. But still, how has it improved the life of the people who are nearby? I guess the bigger question to me is, why is it acceptable, right? Why do we find this an acceptable way of creating our cities? You know, here's a river in Milwaukee. That freeway actually came out, and that building is now, by the way, it's missing its windows here when that picture was taken. When the freeway came down, the promise of that interested in developer, historic tax credit, it's now an office building. It's a productive piece of real estate. Nearby, right, you have the McGrath. I don't know. I mean, I don't know what it was like before, but I'm not sure that the freeway made sitting out on this guy's porch better, right? And so, you know, we do make smart cars, but we make dumb places, right? So how do we match these things up, right? Because again, I'm not a car hater. I'm not anti-car. I just don't like dumb places. And so, as I said, why is it acceptable? And also, what went wrong? right? Like, how did we get here? What happened? Actually, it's actually pretty simple, I think. So this is what I'm trying to discover, is how to explain this simply. Lewis Mumford wrote of the building of a highway has about the same result upon vegetation and human structures as a passage of a tornado or the blast of an atom bomb. So he's kind of mixing the technology bit in, right? Jane had even more precise understanding that frequent streets and short blocks are valuable because the fabric of intricate cross-use that they permit among the users of a city neighborhood. Jane wasn't a planner, urban design, architect, engineer, expert, right? She was an extraordinary citizen, but an ordinary citizen, who understood these things intuitively. Now, Bill Geddes actually designed a lot of beautiful things, and he actually was employed to come up with the concepts of designing the highway system, the interstate system. And here's the diagram that he drew, okay? High speed between cities. You come to a local road, it splits to a network, it splits further and further and further, so that when you get to the city boulevard, you're actually part of a rich network, okay? Someone read the diagram wrong and said, I think it just goes all the way through, right? And this is actually what causes congestion. The fundamental notion of the limited access highway is limited access, which means that there are a few ways on and off. It's controlled access. And in fact, this is what creates the congestion, because everyone's hurrying up to wait to get on or off, right? And they don't distribute. So what we found, we thought we should look into this. What we found, actually, is when those freeways come out and the network is restored, life gets better. Okay? The diagram was there. Now, again, I don't know why it wasn't followed. And I'm not going to go through these in detail. You can find them pretty easily now. There's a recent report by the Institute for Transportation Development Policy, and they feature five completions. Harbor Drive in Portland, the Embarcadero in San Francisco, Park East in Milwaukee, Chungjin in Seoul, and the Inner Ring Expressway in Bogota. They're all examples of freeways that were either taken down or transit replaced an alternative. So it's proof. We can do this. It's not theoretical. And these places got better. How many of you ever went to San Francisco when the Embarcadero was up and you walked, enjoyed the waterfront? How many have you been there since and can tell the difference, right? So where did the cars go? Fewer people, less business going on there? No, actually it got much better all around. There's streetcar, there's not nearly as many lanes concentrated in one place, but the traffic does distribute through the rest of the system. In this report, I'm sorry, you can't read that. What they've done is they're looking worldwide. They have featured in green places where these have been completed, where freeways were removed or avoided, and a number of places around the world where these are being planned or being discussed or being fought about. It's happening. And so, you know, in terms of this failed experiment or evidence of, we know that it's out there. We know that there are examples of rethinks that actually work pretty well. Here's one, for example, that Ian Lockwood worked on in Chattanooga. Here's what was there. You see that river and how easily one gets to the river. They did a plan. They had a vision. They had a different idea about what their waterfront could be in Chattanooga, right? And then they executed it. They got community support They figured out the funding. They figured out how to fix their waterfront. It was like that. This was during the construction. The outcome is that it's a better place. It's actually a fun place. You see on the bottom it says fun map, right? And so they have an annual, they must have all kinds of festivals and things happening here, right? But there was a highway there at once. Someone said, they looked at the demand of the traffic and they said, we have to accommodate that demand. And here's the design for it, two more lanes, this much more money. But the community said, we want something different. So the question is, have we learned something? Do we have confidence, quite frankly, that we can do something about it? The Congress for the New Urbanism, the CNU, has had a program going called Freeways Without Futures. And what they do every year is they kind of list the top 10 potential teardown projects. And they're actively working in each one of these cities with the communities, talking about what might happen, what could happen. The fundamental thing here is that this is about planning the future. This is about talking about what you want as a community and then calibrating the size of the infrastructure to that. Not just assuming that this uncontrollable traffic is just something that has to be there. So there sets up the opportunity for a new campaign, I think. That, we do have an infrastructure challenge. Now, the American Society of Civil Engineers a few years ago identified something like $2.2 trillion was needed. These are the grades. These are not the typical grades of a university student or anywhere around here. But these are D's and C's, D minuses. Overall, D. Roads, I think we're D minus. So what do we do about it? Well, if you read a lot of this information, obviously we need more money. $2.2 trillion at least. If we build things, we'll create jobs, we'll remain competitive, we just need money, that's all, right? Can someone get Henry Ford II to come out and say that, we need money, everyone should support us, it'll be good for everybody? No, that's not where we're at. And, during World War II, England had spent a lot of money on a lot of different things, and I don't know if it was Churchill or Chamberlain who said, gentlemen, we're all out of money, now we have to think. Right? And this is where we probably find ourselves. And the question is, how are we going to think and what are we going to think about? Are we going to think that, we got to think in the future, right? But as a planner, I'm supposed to think in the future. I really like to look at our past as well to figure out where we might have made some wrong turns. What are some things that are avoidable? There's another report, Building America's Future, that an interesting trio of folks, former Governor Rendell, Governor Schwarzenegger, and Mayor Bloomberg are leading this effort. I don't know if you know about this report, but it speaks very much to ideas about leadership and innovation, the mounting crises, losing ground on our global competitors. They adopt strategic funds. They invest at scale. They pioneer new financing mechanisms. They are getting results and some recommendations for reform. This is a competition. This is private business thinking that they need to partner and find ways to influence the public sector. And that's probably good news. Because someone has to do it, and someone has to do something. But despite all of the sort of reactions of the past, as I said, the last multi-year infrastructure law was passed in 2005. We've got to find another way to do this. Now, one little side note. You know, we bailed out the automobile industry and we bailed out the finance mortgage industry, right? But we really didn't require significantly new kinds of products, right? As far as I can tell. We didn't say to these industrial giants, maybe you could focus more on manufacturing the highest quality transit vehicles in the world. Like, maybe we could aspire to that. And even if we don't use them in our own country, the rest of the world does. And there's something good about that kind of trade export thing for creating wealth. Or in mortgage, right? I don't think that there was any significant preference for location-efficient mortgages, preferences for mortgages near transit, within transit. So one wouldn't have to have a car in order to have mobility and could realize ownership. These were opportunities that could have come alongside with that American taxpayer bailing out these private companies. We probably could fix that, but it's probably a reasonable and useful recent lesson. So here's what I just lay out, a few things. The opportunity for a new campaign builds on, I'm suggesting, the same set of values. Freedom and prosperity, the same promises of congestion relief and improved safety. I don't think we can do it. Like, you can't, like, who's going to say no to these things, right? It's really difficult. It's really difficult. The question is, it's sort of like truth in advertising. Really, did I really get congestion relief, and did I really get safety for everybody out of this expenditure? And what is our freedom and prosperity? What does it require? I think it requires us to be clear about the proof of our successes. So those reports, like the ITDP, serve a good purpose. The CNU's efforts. All of our efforts, quite frankly, of becoming more knowledgeable about how these things have worked. Clear messaging, renewed civic vision, and renewed civic will. So what I mean by proof of success is that these solutions are not theoretical. San Francisco, Milwaukee, Seoul, etc., they've happened. These places got better. And oftentimes people say, oh, well, that was a stub band, right? That's an easy one. Oh, what do I do about that? Because there's so many freeways that cut all the way through. Like, there's this argument that we have to accommodate all of this travel, interstate travel that's going through, or regional travel. Why does a city have to take that responsibility? Why does a neighborhood have to take that responsibility on its own? Like, why does that happen? I think if you look at cities that avoided them or stopped them or removed the stub ends, I actually take that as proof that we didn't need them there in the first place, right? Like, when the Embarcadero went in, tens of thousands of cars used it, but it wasn't completed. So when it came out, it's not because it was a stub end. It was because the whole original idea was unnecessary in the first place, right? If you'd be willing to look at it that way. Because, like, the world didn't end when the freeway was stopped, right? The grand plan didn't get completely messed up. Well, maybe someone's grand plan got messed up, right? But for years it existed as a stub, and just got more of it got better after it was taken out. So the challenge is, as Ian always says, central casting, right? He says, you can always tell when people come from central casting, they have the same message, right? It's really good. And, you know, this is something that we need to understand. It's powerfully simple, but it's incomplete, right? Safety, less congestion. Less congestion, safety. Safety and less congestion. A little more safe, right? It's very simple. That's what it surrounds. It's just about universally desirable, but again, incomplete. And the reality is, it's rarely delivered for any extended amount of time. Now, I would say in Detroit, it was delivered, right? Population went from, I don't know, over 2 million to maybe 500,000 now. That is a way, actually, to reduce congestion in your city, is to find ways to have fewer jobs and fewer economic investment, and you take care of congestion. not a great way, not a great plan, not an intention. So the challenge on this messaging that I struggle with, I hope to hear some of your ideas, is how do you add others, like access versus only congestion relief, safer places versus only traffic safety, neighborhoods, quality of life versus only moving vehicles through or over it, transportation choices versus only moving vehicles, investment versus government spending as usual. And what about, is there a chance that we could talk about a shared national agenda that's good for cities, suburbs, and rural America? Now this complicates it, right? And you can see how difficult it is. But this is partly, I think, the lesson of what Jane Jacobs gave us, is the notion that it's a context issue. Each neighborhood is different. Each place is different. The one-size-fits-all solution of the freeway cutting through the city is not appropriate. It's a foreign object in the city. So I think it's also important to clearly identify and distinguish the types to avoid confusing and mixing them. So for example, one type is removing or replacing with a street network, right? Milwaukee, we took out the freeway, put back the street grid. So it creates new development opportunities. So that's really an investment-driven motive. The other is to retain and modify. You have an example of that here, right? You still have a road, but it's in a tunnel, or in other places, they cap over it. So there's that through capacity managed in a different way, has less impact, perhaps, on the local neighborhood, but it still creates and maintains a high dependency on automobiles. And then another version is just sort of leaving it in place. In Seoul, Korea, they left some of the piers, for example, as kind of artifacts of the freeway that used to be there. But if you think of a famous place like the High Line in New York City, right, it's a piece of infrastructure that doesn't serve its original purpose, serves a new purpose, has been repurposed, and famously successful. A renewed civic vision. This is planning. This is what planners do. And land uses have changed. Many of our waterfront freeways were there because nothing else was there. It was easy. It was easy to assemble the land. You weren't really hurting anybody. The idea of getting trucks close to, right? But many waterfronts have changed. I've worked on a lakefront and a riverfront in Milwaukee that dramatically changed. We were working one in Denver. There's a little river in Denver. So with that in mind, this is a matter of committing to new vision and having the willingness to commit to new visions, like doing planning. A lot of folks say, well, this, we don't have the money to build anything now. We don't want to plan, right? Okay. This is a project in Trenton that Ian Lockwood worked on. This was a park along the waterfront that was parked. Well, it was improved with this highway and lots of surface parking and these object buildings, you see, right? It's a perfect expression of a new way of making a city. None of that Main Street stuff, none of the forming of a pedestrian corridor, just buildings plopped down in a sea of asphalt. Convenient for cars, but not really. And they did a plan. On the left, you see the existing street network. On the right, Ian and his team laid out a street grid. They have better capacity in terms of distribution of traffic and travel, and they have development. It's a both and proposition, not either or. Right? This is what their waterfront deserves. It hasn't happened yet, right? They're searching for the funding. There are a number of cities in this position. They're ready to go. Rochester is this way. They've applied for two grants, two Tiger II. They've been turned down. In some ways, many of these cities, maybe they ought to have a certain priority in terms of what they are planning to do. Because what they're proposing to do is actually get off relying on the federal government, reducing the federal burden in a way that they themselves can then take over the street network, and benefit in tax base and jobs and investment in their local community. Right? There's potential for everybody. In Milwaukee, here's that street network ready for development. In Milwaukee, we took this Park East Freeway out. You can see all the surface parking lot, the cheapest parking in the city, something like that. When you were on the freeway, you hardly knew that there was this river. You could have your lunch sitting in your car watching the river, but not a very nice thing, and what an incredible waste of land it was. As part of the plan of the downtown, we did public charrettes. People envisioned and said, hey, there could be a different future for that area. We don't need to have that elevated freeway. We know we need to have streets with capacity, but, you know, we organized a new plan around streets and blocks, new boulevards, extension of a river walk, new urban squares that became centers of new neighborhoods. And so these are sort of visualizations that we created in showing people what could change in the future, how a new urban square could be built. I took these photographs of the befores while the freeway was being torn down, actually. You can see the pile of dust and rubble. That is the former Park East Freeway that was reused. But we used these images to explain and get people excited about it. We had no idea how we were going to pay for a lot of this stuff before we got started, though, which is actually why you need to do the plan, right? If we actually only started planning when we had the money to build something, we would never build anything, I don't think. So this was about a new gateway, providing improved access. Take the freeway out and improve access. Most people don't believe it, but it happens. Can happen. So it's about improving access and improving development opportunity in downtown along the riverfront, changing that condition and allowing it to evolve like it did downstream to a vibrant waterfront, such that there were, you know, stories like this where downtown Milwaukee would provide an escape from suburbia. Okay? Most people don't think of Midwestern post-industrial cities as being the escape from suburbia, right? But these were great stories. All because we planned ahead. We planned ahead and we had a vision. And there's all kinds of new development. What I mean by we planned ahead and why that was important, we had no idea, as I said, how we were going to pay for this. Turned out that Harley-Davidson was interested in doing something called the Harley Experience, the only one in the world. Harley riders are very dedicated individuals to the company, to the product, to each other, to a lot of other things. And they saw in the plan this site. Okay? And they said that would be a perfect place for us to do the Harley Experience, which is a big kind of entertainment center. Big blocks. They liked it. Lined up with the Bradley Center, the auditorium, the convention center, a whole bunch of other kind of destinations. That got the ball rolling. The governor of Wisconsin at the time hated the idea of taking out a freeway, but he was a Harley rider. So he was convinced that it was a great idea. That's what made it happen. Ultimately, Harley didn't go there. They actually went to another site, but we were far enough along and we had the commitment to take the freeway out. The reason why I tell that story is because I'm pretty sure Harley would not have proposed taking down the freeway. Like, they wouldn't have said, well, we'd like to go downtown, we're Harley, and by the way, somebody's got to get that freeway out of our way. I guarantee you, Harley-Davidson, as popular as they are in Milwaukee, would never have proposed that. It was the evidence of the city leadership, the citizenry, the businesses, and the property owners supporting the idea, embodied in an adopted plan, that gave the private sector investor confidence that that should be something they could look into. Right? So it's a way of thinking about how our public infrastructure, in fact, leads investment. Last summer, there were these wildfires in Texas, and this was the picture on the New York Times. It made me think about, you know, the picture was about all the smoke in the top third, you know, all the wildfires, and then, you know, what are we going to do? And, of course, in these emergencies, we find the money to take care of it, and, like, we figure it out. But when I looked at the picture originally, I actually thought, it's the stuff that's, like, that's actually the most threatening thing. Like, fires go out. This is probably the most threatening thing to the future. I know global warming doesn't apply in Texas, but, you know, that is something to think about long term. And when you look at it, I can't really see that highway configuration really is adding a great deal of value for the local neighborhood. Right? We have the ability to find the way to deal with things when we are in a tough spot. You know, we can react, but can we plan? And so this is what I mean in terms of renewed civic will. The past freeway experiment proved technical limits fail in cities. City to city, high speed, very exciting. In cities, not so high speed, not actually real. What I take away from that and all of that campaign is that, more importantly, it proved the enormous change that can be made with political leadership and will. It's possible. It's still possible in this country, I believe. It was possible then, but it takes a lot of effort. And I think, I've been thinking about it. Who leads this? President, state representatives, governors, mayors. I think mayors. Mayors are the ones, in most cases, that have led these efforts because they have a specific interest in mind, and that is the citizens of their cities. Right? And right now, right, the U.S. Conference of Mayors newsletter is discussing how, you know, much they influenced getting this bipartisan bill out of the Senate. And now they're working on the House. Right? And what everybody's hoping for is actually a five-year commitment, not just an extension. The issue is, you know, do we just live by extensions and extensions, or when, or do we commit? Do we commit to a future, and what kind of future will we commit to? So just to, as a conclusion, I do think we need a movement that's rooted in aspirations of freedom and prosperity, but just simply a different approach. One that recognizes, accepts, and learns from our failed freeway experiment. You can say it, we failed, it's okay. Because then we're on our way to learning. Our economic challenges today, a lot of people say, well, we don't have the money. Well, you know what? We can't afford to build or expand the stuff that we have or maintain the things that we have. Why would we try to perpetuate? Why wouldn't we actually be looking for how to get out of it? The federal government, anyways, in local cities, where, in fact, the local can take care of it and make it more productive. Our economic challenge today actually provides an opportunity. China and India are building freeways like crazy, like beyond anything that many of us can imagine. I hope that they figure it out, not only for their sake, but for the sake of the world, quite frankly, in terms of the kind of expensive, intensive infrastructure that is so automobile-based. If they don't figure it out, I think we have so many of these lessons in our own backyard in the United States, we could actually be a leader. And now is a perfect time. This is what we've got. Well, Roger said, land, they're not making it anymore. Well, we got to figure out how to make our cities and live with our land. We physically shape things. We put buildings on, we put roads, we put parks. We physically shape these things. And as Churchill said afterwards, they shape us. But what is a city but the people? It's the people. It's how we make change. It's who we make cities for. We don't make cities for cars. We make cities for people. And so I think that's a good place to start. I think Jane Jacobs had it right. She was proven out to be correct in so many ways. I look forward to having a little discussion about this now. Thank you.
Very interesting. In doing some reading on the history of the interstate program, I was very curious to discover that it was not intended originally to go through cities. In fact, Eisenhower thought of it as the Germans had done it, to connect cities, but not to bash right through downtown. And it was the likes of Robert Moses who changed it into effectively an urban renewal program, or urban removal. That's a comment. But secondly, I wanted to say that here in Boston, I'm from Northampton, by the way, and we have a chip on our shoulders about the Big Dig. And it's too bad that Boston didn't follow the example of the 1960s revolt against the inner loop and the example of Milwaukee in tearing down the expressway, and just simply get rid of the central artery rather than wasting $15 billion plus dollars putting in a tunnel with a mediocre greenway above it. And that's a second comment. One question. Where did you put the rubble from the expressway in Milwaukee?
It was distributed and reused. There were new streets that were put in. I can't remember exactly where everything goes, but I think most of it was reconstituted as part of the new roads that were put in.
So it wasn't transported out to some outlying location?
There may have been some other parts.
Mm-hmm. Because that's obviously one of the big costs of removal.
Yes.
So, I mean, I'm really interested in the sort of history of the freeways, and it strikes me that a lot of the motivation for freeways through cities was to serve suburban commuters. So my question is now, in terms of finding the political will to take out freeways, what type of relationship needs to exist between central cities and suburbs? Does some sort of regional governments need to be formed in some fashion? What sort of relationship exists there?
Does anyone have the answer to that question? It depends. The regional cooperation piece varies greatly across this country, I've found. Right? I think quite frankly, you're right. It did provide access to the suburbs. It did enable a lot of those things. But it also doesn't always work for the suburbanites, right? And so we say, well, we got to fix this. We have too much congestion. Those people keep showing up. Oh, yeah, because they moved. And so how do we fix it? Do we keep expanding? It's clear that we don't have the money to keep doing this. And it's clear that keeping or just adding lanes isn't solving the situation. So where's the common ground? Well, again, part of it is what I'm trying to figure out, how to make it simple. And I appreciate any ideas you guys have. Yeah, I mean, is to actually look at the cost of not just suburban, but rural areas that are not getting infrastructure and bridges repaired that are crucial to interstate travel and freight. It just seems odd that we have this experience, we have this evidence, it ruined the real estate in cities. We also have people returning to cities, young professionals, 20-somethings. They want to be in cities. That's where the action is, right? And there's land, and they're finding land, and developers are finding land in places. And when these freeways are proposed to be removed, developers find these places. It's not a bad thing. It's actually not a bad thing that people want to come back to cities and invest in some of the most dislocated parts and underutilized lands. I think there's actually a common purpose here. It's a little tricky sometimes to explain it quickly because there's so many dimensions.
Switch over to this side for a minute. Yes, with the green hat.
I understand, and I actually accept and believe that places like the Embarcadero, it worked. But the question is why, and it seems to me that it probably comes down to one of two things. Either there were fewer miles driven, or the traffic was displaced. But then, next to the comment, I live in Newburyport, and we're working on a concept of providing pedestrian accessible services, emphasizing, providing services to places you can walk to through a process of creating a nucleus for a neighborhood, which we call neighbor hubs. We don't have any tangible progress yet, but there's quite a bit of discussion going on about, how we can focus services to deliver them to people, to places they can walk to. And I was wondering if you had any comments about, that, if you have seen anything similar, whatever.
What kind of services are you talking about?
Well, for the minimal neighbor hub, I think there are two services. One is food, and the second is transportation. The food can be either in the form of a small grocery, convenience store kind of thing, or food in the form of a cafe, something like that. And, if you combine that with basic transportation services at those locations, then hopefully you get a lot of mutual combination. I think other things could easily be combined. People who, you know, require access to transportation, seniors, people with disabilities, so a housing element, professional services, lawyers' offices, dentists, all that, and just more and more services as you are able, so that people can walk to them.
So I'm not familiar with the area. My first question is, why do you need to call it a neighbor hub?
Well,
all I'm saying is, I mean, what you're talking about is the fundamental nucleus of urbanism. So if it isn't there now, I'd be curious to know what the barriers were in the past for those kind of agglomerations to occur.
Well,
was it zoning? I don't know enough about the place.
I mean, Newburyport's a small city. It's one of the smallest cities in Massachusetts. Population just a little below 20,000. And there is a great downtown. There's also a little bit of a strip outside with the box stores and all that. Generally, it works pretty well. Historically, there were lots and lots of neighborhoods, corner stores, lots of them. They're all gone now. And it was just, they were killed off by having all the cars, which are now choking all the streets. The big problem that has occurred, I think, in the city is that now it's really become a commuter city. So everyone gets up every morning and drives to Boston. Solving that problem is part of the idea with the neighborhoods, because the way it happens, you know, everyone drives their own car, even though we actually have commuter rail and we have bus services going to Boston from the city. You typically have to drive to the locations where those services are offered, and an awful lot of people still drive because, frankly, it's cheaper.
Well, yeah. I mean, again, those patterns that form sometimes are the result of zoning laws and infrastructure standards that make it so. So, in places where I've worked, if we say we want to have urbanism, let's make sure that at least we do no harm, right? First, do no harm, and find out if there are things in the regulations that actually make it difficult for you to do what you want. And then secondly, you know, I mean, part of it is design, and the quality of places and the desirability of places, especially walkable places, because, right, you experience it at a much slower pace. If I'm driving by 40 miles an hour, the amount of detail I need in the building ends up not being that much, which is why those buildings end up not being that much. But you look at a traditional town, and you look at the detail and the scale of, like, where you actually touch the building, then it's meaningful. That's why when you see the cookie cutter box landing somewhere near a main street, it's like a freeway on a main street.
Okay, we're going to do a couple more on this side, and I should be asking people to identify themselves. Phil Langan, identify yourself.
Phil Langan from the newsletter Better Cities and Towns, formerly New Urban News. Can you talk a little bit more about the practicalities of whether you see the need for some sort of a federal amount of money available for taking out freeways? I mean, do you need to have a large amount of money set aside at the federal level, or can you do this by some other method or on a local initiative sort of basis?
I think it could actually be all of those things. I mean, in the case of Milwaukee, there was I can't remember the total amount of actually, I think it was iced tea money, that in the region was kind of up for grabs, couldn't get folks to decide what to do. So the governor came in and said, oh, we're going to take the freeway down because Harley wants to go there. Is it necessarily more money? I guess the other part of that is trying to figure out how do we value our time dollar relationship. You know, because, like I said, we do have a situation, we've had a couple situations where we have the funding or we're going after funding, but we have to do this if we're going to be successful bringing the dollars home. Okay, but if it's a dumb thing, would it be okay if we just let somebody else have the money? No, that's obviously political, so then I'm not doing my job, right? Okay, so short term, you're going to work on getting the money for us to build something that we know is not that great, but short term, makes you look good. Sounds reasonable to me, right? I mean, so I do think that to the extent that HUD and EPA and DOT are sharing criteria in terms of evaluation or proposal. I think if they, I mean, they're pretty explicit about it. If in fact the decisions are made in ways that actually highlight those kind of projects that would create more walkable places, that would actually remove damaging elements in cities.
I'm Peter O'Connor, and until recently I was Deputy Secretary for Real Estate and Economic Development at the state DOT. I was interested in the way you framed the sort of push and pull or the history as a campaign that created the interstate transportation, created the interstate highway system, and now calling for a campaign for a different kind of highway system. And the campaign that created the interstate highway system as we have it today wasn't really a grassroots campaign. We saw Henry Ford and his newsreels, and I think the gas companies were probably had something to do with it, and the construction companies. So there were all these economic forces behind the creation of that first campaign. So I guess my question is to you is, who's going to lead this new campaign? And where do the economic forces, if any, that would be aligned behind that to push that along?
I like everybody's thoughts on that one. As I said, I mean, I do think mayors are a big part of it. They have some very direct stakes. But do they have enough influence? What I observe between cities and DOTs is they have to find ways of asserting that influence, and that depends on the composition of their constituencies and how they manage to build those constituencies and what those constituencies are comprised of. Did you have an idea?
I did, actually. I agree with you that it's mayors. Ashley Emerson of the Department of Housing and Community Development, but I think we also need partners that already have a lobbying structure, and one that speaks to me is AARP. There are some valid reasons why they would support this, more walkable communities, as you were kind of talking about, as they're serving a population and they have that lobbying infrastructure already there. So that was something that came to mind.
I think I promised one more here.
Wait, before you get, Fred, did you have an idea for the answer to that last? I just was curious.
Yeah. We'll go back to Fred, actually. We'll get you.
In light of the McGrath Highway project that you mentioned, I'm curious how you initiated the discussion in Milwaukee with Wisconsin DOT or with other stakeholders in the project to pull down that highway. And how do you make a compelling argument? How do you convince them?
So the question was essentially like, how do we create that constituency? And how do we deal with the DOT?
Yeah.
So again, it was a plan by the city. Wisconsin law requires plans, comprehensive plan, etc. So we had to do the plan for downtown. We did the plan, and as part of the visioning, asking people 20 years from now, what happens in downtown? What does it look like? What's the transportation look like? Overwhelming support for converting the one-way streets back to two-way in downtown, and that's happened. The building of a new year-round public market, that happened. Extension of the Riverwalk, that happened. New housing, that happened. Everything happened, including folks just didn't imagine that these freeways would have any reason to be there in the future. Now, that wouldn't probably have happened had we done that plan 10 years earlier, because people had very little confidence in downtown Milwaukee. But what they saw are things happening in and around downtown. When we talked about it, we said, you see the river, how successful it is here. Look at what it looks like with the freeway there. Do you think the freeway's helping it? Obviously not. Okay. If it were gone, what could it be? Well, it could be just about anything. It could be even better than the Riverwalk. So it was a matter of kind of revealing experiences of places that people could believe in, and helping through a planning process and a public charrette process extend their confidence and build that confidence more widely.
And Wisconsin DOT was receptive?
No. No, they were really doubtful about it. And they just, at every turn, would just say, this isn't going to work. And then we did the modeling, and they're like, oh, it could work, right? Actually works better in some spots, right? Because it you actually distribute the traffic to where it wants to go. You know, that is changing the paradigm of how decisions and how, I mean, I don't think the DOT guys are bad people. I mean, they're just, here's how they're trained, here's what they're taught to do, here's what the variables they're dealing with just aren't as wide as what a neighborhood or city might care about in breadth, but also in variety of combinations. And that's the stickiest part, I think, of what this is about, is how do you clarify it? Like, we say there are basic design principles that are always present for thousands of years of civilization. But we've also got, the modern period where, we have whole generations of architects who are taught to eschew all of that history. It's meaningless, right? We're starting over. So it's, it's a big challenge.
Fritz, how about you get to last?
I just wanted to make a couple of comments. I love the presentation. I disagree strongly with calling upon saving money as a value. The U.S. economy is in terrible shape. And one of the few places where there are domestic jobs is in constructing and reconstructing infrastructure. So I think that's an important building block, not something to say, well, we can save money. That just invites one possible constituency.
You build
away.
Something else.
Yeah.
The real power, I think, in the iced tea dynamic in 1990-91 was that there were enough people willing to say that the surface transportation authorization should not continue unless it changes. We should not just keep spending money on, let's just rebuild McGrath Highway elevated because we don't have the imagination to do anything else with the money. So I think the key is that we should want the money, but we should want a way of doing something better than it in most cases. And a device to do that, I agree with you that the mayors are, no INS is going to be perfect, but they're the best hope for an institutional base that will care about a broader view of things than a DOT, which kind of wants to do what it was told to do 5 years ago. The mayors have a much better chance of getting to a good place. So, well, let's remember, it was the mayors who demanded that the Eisenhower Institute came into the cities. So that desire to get the money has historically led to some bad places. Mm-hmm. But you got to make choices, and I would agree with your choice that the mayor is the place. I disagree with the theories about regionalization. If it were up to a regional referendum in the Boston metropolitan area, the Inner Belt and the Southwest Expressway would have been built right through the neighborhoods. It was the small municipal size and the mayors who responded to the smaller constituency saying, we don't want it, that turned it around in Boston. It doesn't always work. It's Mayor Curtin in Somerville who's fighting for the McGrath to be changed to a boulevard rather than just rebuilt. If they were up to the region as a whole, while we have, I think it's fair to say, an unusually good Metropolitan Area Planning Council on some of these matters, over time you would expect the Metropolitan Agency to say, just build it, I want to drive through. So I think the mayor is a very important building block. The key is most of this bad stuff, the really bad stuff, got built before the National Environmental Policy Act. The interstate system was 1956, National Environmental Policy Act is 1970, which on paper dramatically changes the way of doing the rules. But the flaw in it is that it's the highway agency that gets to conduct the environmental impact statement. If there were a way to shift the locus to say these things have got to be dealt with, they're falling down, either tear them down and make them boulevards or rebuild them in some cases. You need a mechanism to decide, but it shouldn't be decided by an agency whose whole being is we just keep doing more of the same or rebuilding more of the same. So if there were a way to build a constituency of mayors who said, we want the money, but we don't want to see reauthorization if it just means another 6 years of all the money going to the state DOT so we can go hat in hand and beg and maybe get a few extra trees planted as they, you know, I think those are the building blocks you want. But to me, it begins with, you do want the money spent, and the excellent report that you pointed out, if I'm remembering which of these reports it is, the one with the Schwarzenegger and, they call upon, and they had a couple of economists who supported the view that rather than a gasoline tax, which is perceived as adding to the price of gasoline, they're proposing essentially a windfall profits tax on the petroleum companies. I mean, the price of pumping oil out of the sand in Saudi Arabia is not anything like what we look at here. We are paying the tax. It's just going to building stuff in Dubai and in Saudi Arabia. So what's proposed in that report is that of the money people are spending anyway in gasoline, let's capture that to spend in the United States. And some of it will build stuff that we don't like. But if we can change the rules and insist that the 1970 National Environmental Policy Act reform applies to how this money gets used, we got a chance to win some victories in important cities, I think. That's the way I'd approach it.
Thanks, Frank.
Last thought?
Just thanks very much for coming today. And if you have other thoughts, ideas for me to think about, you can email me.
Or come on, Pete will be here for a minute.
He'll be around.